Leo the Lion's best friend, A. Arnold Gillespie. Everyone calls him by his Hollywood dean of special effects. And Oz presents him with his greatest challenge. Buddy Gillespie must create a dazzling array of special effects, many of them never before attempted. A floating farmhouse and a floating head. A melting witch and flying monkeys. Fireballs, talking trees, and a terrifying tornado. Ever wonder how this special effect was accomplished? Gillespie drops a miniature farmhouse from the top of a soundstage. He shoots it in slow motion and later will reverse the film so the farmhouse appears to be falling into the camera. The floor of the soundstage is painted to look like a Kansas sky with some dry ice vapor for clouds. The most astonishing illusions often have the simplest explanations. Buddy Gillespie reveals his solution to a spectacular effect no one has ever tackled before.
The Wizard of Oz, of course, presented a lot of very, very interesting problems, and the tornado was one of the toughest, naturally, that we had faced. We didn't quite know what to do. But anyway, the tornado was finally resolved by building a funnel type of thing out of muslin, and we put the top part of the thing on a gantry that moved the full length of the stage, and the lower part of the tornado was went into a slope in the floor with an S sort of a pad, and it progressed towards the camera with a dustpan with Fuller's Earth, which gave the cloud of dust at the bottom, and the tornado was about 30 some odd feet in length.
Special effects sequence and disasters on the set.
From one standpoint of the work was that the hours were long and the time off from work was short. During this period, we had to have our dinner, sleep, and get back up again at 5 o'clock in the morning. We hardly ever arrived home earlier than 7:30 or 8. So you see what a short time we had. There's no recreation, none whatsoever. Judy, of course, being a girl, but she had to have her hair done every morning. She had to have it exactly the same way it was the day before.
Composer Harold Arlen's home movies provide the only backstage glimpse of the stars of Oz, all of whom managed to keep their spirits up despite long hours, intense heat, and uncomfortable wardrobe and makeup.
A lot of people ask me about the costumes. I had a rubber mask. The only unfortunate thing about it was that it sort of closed the pores in my face. And when the lights got real hot in there and ate up all the oxygen, I couldn't breathe. But worst of all, Bert Law. His costume was 90 pounds. With a perfectly ridiculous kind of costume put on a fellow like Bert Law, because Bert Law was a nervous type. Bert Lahr, he was always undoing the buttons. He always had gas on his stomach. He couldn't eat anything. And in his costume, it was literally true. He couldn't eat anything.
Jack Haley recalls his miseries.
I was doing a radio show. I had my own radio show. And staying up late with the writers. So I had to be on what they call a reclining board. And I would go to sleep as soon as I got on the reclining board. And Bert Lahr said, "That Haley can sleep on a beef hook."
In a film that is breaking new ground, there are all sorts of unexpected accidents and injuries. For Margaret Hamilton, Oz is a frightening experience that she will always remember.
It was the end of my first scene in the picture. And she pulls around and stands on this little elevator that went down slowly or went down fast. In this case, it dropped out from under me. It left my feet and I followed it. And it went just like clockwork, and that's the one you see. The first one we did. Then we came back from lunch and everybody again is tired. It was all just one mistake after another. And I stepped down, smoke all came up and I went down. I felt just something warmth on my face. And then there were some droppings and things burning. And I thought, what in the world is that? I had a wonderful young man, Jack Young, who really saved my life. And he was right there and grabbed a hold of me, and we ran to the first aid station on the set. And where he began working on my face to get the makeup off. We didn't know this until early the next day, but I had a second degree on my face and third on my hand. After he got the makeup off, which was very traumatic for me, because it hurt so much, I was just, you know, you sort of tremble, you just can't help it, I was just shaking with it. And finally he got through, and he said, oh, I know, it's been awful, I need to go out and tell you about it. Right now, I want you to know that there's copper in that makeup, and if I didn't get that off, it would have gone on eating into your face.